Our second speaker this afternoon is Professor Peter Schneider from Minster, who will speak about differential graded AKI algebras.
Thank you. When I first met Josef and coincidentally also David Kashtan at around the same time, the word "met" just meant that I was sitting in Josef's course on D modules and was listening. It did not occur to me at that time that I later would be able to speak to them and even have the privilege to work with them. As many of you have expressed, I know hardly any mathematical work of the same clarity and beauty as Josef's. So I feel it's a real honor to stand here and speak at this conference. Let me maybe put the very basic notations here. So F is any local field, any fixed local, probably I should write bigger, field of residue characteristic, positive residue characteristic P, and G is the group of F points of a connected reductive group over F. And then little k is any field for now, any field, and that's the coefficient field for the modules or representations I will consider. And then mod g is the category of abelian category of smooth G representations over K. Okay, so these are the very basic notations. Now, of course, all of you know what Hecke algebras are, but I feel I have to put things into perspective. I have to begin with repeating a little bit of background. So let's take I in G be any reasonable compact open subgroup but actually apart from this very first remarks I will always take and so I can say this right away here I always is a pro-P Iwahori subgroup. Of G. So Iwahori subgroup means it's the pointwise stabilizer of a phase of the maximal chamber in the building, and pro-P means then it's the pro-P pseudo subgroup of such a Iwahori subgroup. So that's certainly reasonable. And then we form the compact induction from so X is the compact induction of the trivial representation from I to G, which I mean you can everything is over little k, so you could just say it's a vector space spanned by the cosets in G by I and GX by left translation. Together, and it's Hecke algebra, simply denoted by H, which is the endomorphism ring, G endomorphism ring of this. Of this smooth representation, and actually I am used to take the I want to act this from the right, so I always take the opposite ring. Now, okay. So we have a pair of adjoint functors. Right, between the modules, so mod H is simply the category of left H modules, mod H and mod G, denote them maybe by frac T and frac H. And so a module, if I have a module, I can tensor it with these over H with my representation and getting in this way a smooth G representation. And if I start with a smooth G representation, I can take its fixed vectors under I. And I mean, it's most convenient to see this, to see the module structure, to see this as the homomorphisms, G homomorphisms of X into V. I take invariants. So now, I mean, there is this work by, maybe I put this here. I think this started with Borel and then in the Ibohori case for admissible representations, and then Josef developed a general framework to deal with this in characteristic zero. So suppose the characteristic of F is zero, then, I mean, let me maybe, I could say what the image is, but I don't do that. So then T is a fully faithful embedding with left inverse H. Of course, one can say exactly what the image is, but that's not important right now. Characteristic, oh, sorry. Yeah. Thank you very much, of course. Okay. On the other hand, so Olivier in her thesis showed, no, so now we suppose that the characteristic of K is P, right? The same P as the one over there. Then the same holds for a few groups, the same holds for G, basically Frank 1, so let's say GL2 QP of Frank 1 over the field QP, SL2 QP, PGL2 QP. But breaks down otherwise. And breaks down really, I mean, in both cases, either if you stick to this algebraic group but increase the field, or you raise the rank of the group. In both directions, the statement, it does not hold anymore. Exactly. This is here for the Propi Ibohori or the Ibohori. The first one is true, I mean, for any reasonable, whatever this means, compact open subgroup. There is some conditions on I in general which guarantee this here. I mean, Borel did it for also only for the Ibohori, but I mean, you had this general framework. So let me, so maybe I put this here. From now on, let me, we are interested, of course, in the characteristic P case. So from now on, assume that the characteristic of K is P. You see, the trouble already is that in that case, of course, these functors have no reason to be anymore to be exact. So functors T and H are no longer exact. So it's a plausible idea that one should pass to a derived picture. But one has to be a little bit careful about this. If you just would derive these functors to functors between the derived categories of H modules and on one side and smooth G representations on the other side, nothing would really change. I mean, the problems would remain. You see already the H here. The H is, you can think of HOM of X into X, or and HOM already has derived functors. Or you can think by Frobenius reciprocity, you can H, at least as a vector space, also consider as the I invariants in X. So it's H0, right, as this functor applied to X. And it has derivatives. So one already has to derive the H here first. Maybe I put this over here. Sure, already, yeah. But mysteriously, you have, even for the abelian categories, you still have some statement. But already in that case, the derived thing is a non-trivial thing. Yeah. I will for now, I will do this maybe later, a little later when I have introduced more notation. For now, the difference is minimal. You can think of the Ivo-Hori group if you prefer. It's in characteristic P. It's useful to have a pro P group for I, and it's more convenient to work with a pro P group. But that's not an essential difference. So, okay, so we form the, so what do? We pick an injective resolution of X. So the category mod G has enough injective objects, we can pick an injective resolution and form the DG endomorphism algebra H dot now, which is the, and I mean the endomorphisms of the injective resolution. And here, of course, the endomorphism has a degree. So here, this is again a complex, and the dot, the degree, is the degree of the endomorphism of I, and the differential of I induces a differential on this complex, and of course, the multiplication is just the composite of endomorphisms. This one, no. And of course, I have to be consistent. I have to again to take the opposite.
Is this the same as the X, you know, the X algebra?
I will come to that. Not on the nose, of course, but I will come to that. So first, a little. I seem to have made a choice here. So it's an exercise that H dot up to quasi-isomorphism does not depend on the choice of this resolution. And also to immediately see the connection to the original Hecke algebra is that if you so, right? I mean, this is a differential graded algebra, so the its cohomology is a graded algebra. So if you take H0 of H dot, so the endomorphisms of the resolution of degree zero up to homotopy. I mean, I should sorry. This no, I think this is this is true. So H0 means the endomorphisms of H of degree zero modulo homotopy, and that's exactly the endomorphisms of X, so we get the Hecke algebra H back. Okay. So now the reason for all of this is the following theorem, which I proved some years ago. Namely, now we can also in this context, we can derive these functors. I won't write down how they how this concretely looks. It's not important for the following. But I have to make one assumption. Suppose that my Propi Ivohori subgroup is torsion free, has no elements of finite order, then the derived functors between the derived category now of differential graded H dot modules and the original DG, so left of T, right derived of H, quasi inverse equivalences of triangulated categories. No, nothing is bounded here. DG really means the unbound. I should have said this maybe here. I mean, I didn't define this. So this is the unbounded derived category of mod G. Okay, so this is my motivation to try to look at this DG Hecke algebra at all and to try to understand it. Now, oh, you have this business of K resolution, K injective and K projective resolutions. Yeah. No. I mean, I think this is a general terminology in category theory. No, they are in, if you want, forget about inverse, or about quasi. I mean, one functor is inverse to the other.
But
yeah.
Why?
No. I mean, no. This is specific to characteristic P. So now coming back to this question, I mean, this of course, I mean, at least for me, so far, this is very difficult to try to understand this full differential graded algebra. So at the moment, I'm happy if I could understand its cohomology algebra, and that's so we come to this question. Right? I mean, the cohomology is a graded algebra. Yeah.
I think torsion free. That's some assumption on the group or on the field.
On the group. I mean. Yeah, I mean, it's formally on the group. The group should have no element of finite order, I mean, non-trivial element of finite order. So, for example, I mean, if you take SL2 QP for the group G, then this is true if P is at least 5. But of course, if you pass to extension fields, you can have, in principle, many elements of finite order. So the answer is yes, right? I mean, the cohomology algebra is just the X'd groups in, now I have to be careful, I have to write in which category, mod G of the representation X with itself, which we can also express by Frobenius reciprocity, right, as the cohomology of I with coefficients in X. But I mean, here the product on H induces here the Yoneda product of extensions. I mean, to be precise, the opposite of the Yoneda product . But here, somehow, we don't see this anymore. So on not directly visible. On this cohomology groups. I will come back to this point. Okay, as I said, for now, the goal is to see as much, to find out as much as possible about the cohomology algebra. And this is, all what follows is joint work with Rachel Olivier. Unfortunately, in characteristic P, this category of G representations has no projective objects. So the main technical tool to analyze the cohomology algebra is the following. And now let me make some simplifying assumptions on the group. So for simplicity, maybe I put this here. So now, from now on, I also assume for simplicity that G is F-split semi-simple, simply connected. SLN, for example. And then we need more notation. So fix a maximal F-split torus T in G, and it should lie, because I've chosen already the Ivohori lying in the apartment. I mean, maybe this is not a formally correct way to say this, but lying in the apartment corresponding, not corresponding, lying in the apartment of I, right, the story correspond to apartments in the building of G, and then I corresponds to a chamber in the building, and I mean this chamber should lie in the apartment of T. And then I need in T, since it's split, it's just the multiplicative group of F to some power, so it has the maximal compact subgroup T0, the units of the field of the ring of integers to the same power, maximal compact subgroup, and then in there I have the maximal pro P subgroup, so pro P zero T1. And then I define the, I don't know, modified while group W tilde is the normalizer in G of T modulo T1. So this means we have then a short exact sequence, right? This I mean with T0 T1 modulo T1, I abbreviate by omega, and this sits into in W tilde, and the quotient is the affine Y group of this simply connected group. And now coming back to the other question, the omega is also exactly the difference between the, I mean, this is a group of order prime to P, and it's the difference between the Ivohori and the Popi-Ivohori subgroup. Okay. And now the point is, so maybe I put this here. We have the Breuer-Titz decomposition. G is the disjoint union of the double cosets with respect to I, where W runs over this modified Y group, and therefore, right? I mean, if you think of this as the cohomology in I, it suffices if things are I equivariant. So we can decompose our X into the direct sum of all W, X W, I abbreviate XW, XW, where XW is now the induction, so to speak, from I to the double coset IWI. I mean, all functions in the induction which are supported on this double coset. This is an I invariant decomposition, and so I can correspondingly decompose the cohomology groups into the direct sum over the W H star I. And maybe let me, I think I want to introduce some abbreviation. Simply write small h star W, where h star W is now the cohomology of this piece here. And now each of these pieces, so H star W, if I write this out again here, I have H star I, the induction. But this, of course, is, right, as an I representation. The action is through this here. This is the same H as H star I. and then the induction from IW to I, where IW is the intersection I intersected WI, W inverse. And now here, this is by Shapiro, Shapiro's lemma, the same as the cohomology of the subgroup open subgroup IW with trivial coefficients. And if you want a reminder of the map, then this is just the given by a map on the coefficients, which is the evaluation in W. I'm not sure. If I might need the notation later, I call this Shapiro W. So that's the technical tool, and that it really, I mean, it seems, so far this seems to have nothing to do with the multiplication, but the basic result about the multiplication in the X-t algebra is the following. So if we take two elements in the modified Weyl group and we multiply hi v times hj w. So by dot, in the following dot will always denote the multiplication here, the opposite of the Unita product, the multiplication in the X algebra. So then this is contained in the direct sum of all hi plus j u, where u runs over the double cosets which are contained in the product. Of the original double cosets, so which are finally many. So this already indicates that this kind of innocent-looking decomposition is useful for studying this algebra. It also would allow. I will not. Well into this, but it also allows to filter this algebra. I mean, this allows to filter the cohomology algebra by the length of W. This has a, the affine Weyl group has a, of course, has the usual length function, and it's extended to this here by giving the elements in omega length zero. So by the length of u with, and then the associated graded with a finite dimensional graded quotients. I should maybe, to be precise, I should say that at least if now the characteristic of F is zero. If it's positive, I think it's not known whether the cohomology groups here, these cohomology groups are finite dimensional. Okay, so that's the starting point. Now let me go through some general structure this cohomology algebra has. first of all, it carries a canonical anti-automorphism, which is constructed using this here. So first we can do something, I mean, this looks again, it looks pretty naive, but it works. So define the K-linear automorphism J of the cohomology, the full cohomology. So I do this piecewise, right? I use on the piece H star W, I use Shapiro to identify this with H star IWK. Then I use conjugation by W minus 1 to map this to H. I mean, conjugation by W minus 1 maps this group isomorphically onto the group IW inverse, K. Then I use Shapiro again to go back to, oh. H star W minus 1. Okay, so I do this piecewise and I put them together. I get a K-linear automorphism of the whole thing. And then the proposition is J is an anti-automorphism of the cohomology algebra. And let me write out precisely what this means, because we are in a graded sense, so there's some in the graded setting there's some sign involved. J of alpha times beta is minus 1 to the degree of alpha times degree of beta, J of beta times J of alpha. So the degree refers to the cohomology degree, of course. And okay, the proof, I mean, I won't give the proof, but the proof uses the next step. The proof uses technically the next step, okay, maybe I can start this here. So the next step is that there is a much more naive product, which is the cup product . So we can, this starts from the observation that, right, on our representation X, I mean, these were just the right invariant functions, the right I invariant functions on G, I would say the functions on G mod I, which with finite support, we can multiply them. The G invariant, G equivariant, map X tensor, okay, by X to X, which is just multiplication, pointwise multiplication of functions, gives rise, we can use this for a cup product pairing, gives rise to the cup product. Hi x tensor over k h j I x to, I mean, of course, h I plus j at first in the tensor product, and then I can use this to go to x again. So that, of course, completely respects this decomposition, right? Because the product cannot increase the, I mean, the support of the product is in the sections of the support, so it can't increase it. So this means let me first say, so under Shapiro, I mean, this product is defined on each piece, right? And if I use Shapiro, this becomes the usual under Shapiro, this becomes the usual product with trivial coefficients on H star IWK. And therefore, I mean, because it's component-wise, right, we have that HIV cup HJW is zero whenever V is different from W. So this is something, it looks like something very trivial and highly unlikely that this is in any way related to the to our Yoneda product, but that's not so. So let me first write by this formula. Right, I can write. So let's take now two elements which have a degree, alpha in HIV, beta in HJW. And then from this here we know already that the product is of the form alpha times beta is of the form sum of gamma u's, classes gamma u's in H in H I plus J U, where U was running over the double cosets contained, the finitely many which are contained in this product. And now I won't give you the precise formula because this is very technical and I would have to introduce further notations and so on. I will give you a nice consequence of it. But I will state the proposition, so the key technical proposition. Only inverts, so gamma u can be expressed by an explicit formula only involving the cup product and homological restriction and co-restriction maps. Okay, and and this explicit formula then also shows that really only those U occur here on the right hand side. Let me write down a precise formula in a very special case because it's a kind of a nice formula. Namely, let's suppose that the lengths of the two elements add up. So L of length of VW is L of V plus L of W. Then the formula reduces, so we have alpha times beta. Maybe I should first, let me do this here. Right, in H, I mean, H has this basis. I mean, if you look at this decomposition here for H0, so for the fixed elements in X, right, then you see if the fixed element in here is exactly the characteristic function of this double coset. So that's the usual Matsumoto basis of H. So this is here the direct sum of all WK times tau W, which is the characteristic function of the double coset. So if the lengths add up, then we can express the product of two general elements using only the cup product and multiplication by elements in H0. And the formula is the following. It's tau V times beta cup alpha times tau W. So this is again the multiplication, but now you see one factor is in H0. These products have the effect, I mean, they lie in different, right? Alpha was in the V component, beta was in the W component. Now if the lengths add, these multiplications by these elements in H0 have the effect that both are mapped into the V times W component, and there the cup product makes perfect sense and is something non-trivial. Okay. So now, see, duality. Which formula?
Product of two.
Two of lengths one?
Yes.
No, I mean, I have a formula always, except that it's, of course, very complicated.
Complicated.
Yeah. Unfortunately, let's say I take two elements, so there is no simple analog like for tau S square. So if I take a generating involution and the product is, the formula is still complicated. So here I do assume, so here assume that I is torsion free. Because then we are in a nicer situation, even apart, I mean, this is what I'm going to say now is used in the proof of the theorem, but it has nothing to do with the theorem as such. In this case, one knows from Lazar that all these IWs are Poincaré groups of course of the same dimension, I mean, they're all open in I, of dimension D, which is the QP dimension of G, if you want. I mean, yeah, really QP, even if we are, I mean, first of all, I should maybe say that this assumption forces the field to be of characteristic zero. Yeah, of course, in characteristic P, I always has many elements of order P. And we can speak then, even if you are over a finite field extension of QP, we can speak of the QP dimension. And of course that, right, I mean this in particular, Poincaré means in particular right, Poincaré means that there is only cohomology, these groups only have cohomology up to degree D, and because of this here, you see that then the cohomology algebra only sits in degree 0 to D. So H star of H dot is 0 for
dot bigger than D.
So then the Komolgi algebra is degree, I mean, has only finitely many degrees. I guess I can. And then the other thing, right, which I'm going to use in a moment is Poincaré group means that the for these groups, the cut product pairing is a non-degenerate duality on the between the cohomology groups. And since we have to combine them, I have first to say, so we have the G equivariant, if you want trace map, it's a simple, very simple thing.
Excuse
yeah?
What is the Poincaré group in this study? What does it mean?
That's exactly the definition. The cohomology, let's say, with FP coefficients, cohomology groups are finite dimensional, so of degree of Poincaré group of degree D means, so they exist only up to degree D. In degree D, it's one dimensional, and the cut product has to be then a non-degenerate pairing into degree D. Maybe sigma from the induced thing to K, I just sum over the values. G in G by I, F of G. I mean, by finite support, this is well defined. And so I can combine this with a cut product, right, giving me HIX tensor HJIX. So we go into the, is it still somewhere? No, it has disappeared. It goes in HI plus J of X, that was the cut product, but now I follow on the coefficient with that map and I get a map. Ah, so I consider this only for in complementary degrees. So this is HD minus I. So it goes into HD, then I follow this with this map on the coefficients, so I end up in HDI with trivial coefficients, and that's one-dimensional isomorphic to K. And so we get K-linear maps right from HIX into the linear dual of this here, HD minus IIX linear dual. So this means K linear dual. And what is not difficult to see is these are injective with image the finite linear forms which I will denote in the following by writing finite. So then this is a linear isomorphism. Finite means the linear form is supposed to vanish on all but finitely many of these components. And so far, this is just linear, but the proposition says the above map is an isomorphism of H, H bimodules. So now let to indicate how this goes, let me write it in X terms. So X I mod G X comma X, this is this one, into, so here I have X d minus I mod g. I leave a little space because there comes some decoration in a moment. And the finite linear dual of this here. But now I have to, right? I mean bimodule. So the right H module structure here comes, of course, I mean, on X, I only have H acting from the right. So the right here makes the right module structure outside. The right here makes the left module structure outside. But here I dualize, so the thing gets reverted, and I have to make good for this. So I write here J, where Jx denotes X made into a left, which originally is a right H module, into a left H module via J, which was an anti-automorphism. So this means that somehow in this, under this assumption, if we know one half of these cohomology groups, then we know the other half in some sense as well. Let me, 5 minutes maybe. So let me at the end, so this is what we have so far about general structure. Let me, so we did for the group SL2F, we computed, I think, in complete detail, H1. Of course, I won't give this to you because these are many technical formulas, but I want to indicate a few things, positive and negative. So now let's take G to be SL2. And let me assume that P is different from 2, Q is different from 3. There are some extra complications, computational nature. And also that my field contains the residue field of F. This also simplifies things. And then, No. Recall that the center of H is known by the work of my Franz Vigneras, and let me just say here, it's a little bigger, but it's basically a polynomial algebra. Algebra in an explicit element zeta. And now the first disappointing negative thing is that this zeta is no longer central in the cohomology algebra. I have no formal statement, but I'm pretty convinced that the center of the cohomology algebra is very, very small. Positive, explicit. So now let's again assume that, I is torsion free. Then zeta centralizes the top cohomology group, centralizes HD of H dot, and we have an explicit description of it. HD dot is isomorphic. So I localize the original Hecker algebra in this central element zeta. And I divide out the kernel. This Hecker algebra has something like the trivial character, which is called the trivial character. So I divide out the trivial character as H, H bimodules. So from this you can see many things. I mean, this means it's largely, I mean, H, this kernel sits of course in H, and H modulo the kernel is one-dimensional, the trivial module. It contains this, and all the rest is Zeta torsion. So this thing actually is a huge Zeta torsion piece plus a one-dimensional trivial H module. Maybe I skipped the last, but let me say two more things. So, as I said, we computed, I think, really completely this one as an H bimodule. And for example, it is finally generated. As H comma H bimodule, but if so, now if here I need if the characteristic of F is zero, it's not true. I mean, all finite generation assertions in this context cannot hold in positive characteristic. But I think this is maybe a coincidence because it's already this here is not finally generated as bimodule. So not true for HD. So maybe this is not such an interesting statement. Let me finish with the following thing, which is kind of strange. What seems to be true is the following finite generation property in great generality, although it's again not satisfying because, right, I mean, the H1 is not centralized by zeta. So I can view it as a left. I can localize it from the left or from the right. So I'll do it from the left. And I can also do it from the right. They are different. I mean, maybe they are exchanged, these modules, by the anti-automorphism. But strictly speaking, they are different modules and are finitely generated. As H zeta modules. This is a left one, this is a right one. They are finally generated, again, if characteristic is zero. And that also holds, I mean, that is very easy to see from two, also holds by two. For HD. And I think, let's say, over a QP where D is SL2QP, then D is 3, we know it also for H2. So this seems to have a chance to be always true, except it's not so nice because of 1. Okay, maybe I finish with this, yeah. Thank you very much.
No,
unfortunately, I don't think so. I do not have a, I mean, I don't know this in a formal way, but I very much doubt it because of the following. So the theorem with the category equivalence holds whenever I don't need algebraic group and I just need a periodic Lie group and an open compact subgroup, P torsion free pro P subgroup. Then it holds. So, for example, I can take the case where G is equal to I. And then I get for the DG, I get just the cochain DGA of I. And there it's a theorem of Posizelski that this is formal. If this is formal, then the group has to be commutative. So from this, I doubt it very much that that in the case which interests us, where of course G is very different from I, this is formal.
So do you know how to transfer any of these things over to
the dual group. So, you know, the Ewald-Hardy hash algebra, it's modules, irreducible modules have parameters on the dual group side. Here you'd expect
have they?
Group over K.
Have they in characteristic P?
Well, the mod P language.
They should have, but.
Some connection to the.
Yeah, but they expect, so it's so far expectation. So I don't know. I think so far there is no for the Hegge algebra in characteristic P, there is no geometric interpretation, right? Like in characteristic zero, where you need some K group, which is at the base of the of this Kasztan-Lustig classification. There is so far no analog in,